Welcome, Super Ninfriendos, to another exciting episode of Nintendo Voice Chat. I'm your host, Seth Macy. Check this out. I've got a hole in the sleeve of the elbow of my flannel because I was cutting wood in the woods with it. I am joined live from a mountain stronghold, Reb Valentine.
That's so rustic and cool of you, Seth Macy.
Hell yeah, thank you. Head honcho, Jada Griffin.
Hey, it's me.
And my friend and your friend, too, Brian Altano. Brian, welcome back to the show.
Good to have you. Is that really how you ripped your shirt?
No, it's I used to wear the shirt to work, and it just eventually wore out.
Did you lie to me? Why'd you lie to me?
You work from home in a basement in Maine. How do you rip your clothes?
Here's the thing. I've had this shirt for probably 10 years.
So. He was just video gaming that hard, Brian.
Yeah.
He was so into his game of whatever that is on the TV behind him.
It's just like when you play like Mario Kart or anything, and any racing game, and you swerve. Like, he just swerved with his elbows so hard.
Do you still do that? The thing where you actually move your hands while you drive?
I 100% do.
It's my favorite thing is watching in like TV shows or movies or commercials when people are supposed to be playing video games in big scare quotes and they've got like these third party made up controllers in their hands and they're just like flailing all over the place.
Well, I remember the thing with Mario Brothers on NES was watching kids like physically lift it to make him jump, right? Yeah. Like they would just be like boing boing.
Yep.
You'd be like, you amateur.
I have a couple of quick little housekeeping things that I need to touch on. I have my wrote him down on a card here like David Letterman. that's a two lies and a truth fact about me. I was on a David Letterman top 10 list at one point in my life. Okay. I want to shout out to Logan for holding it down last week. That's a story for a different time. Awesome job, Logan. Logan couldn't be here this week. Also, I've got some exciting videos coming to IGN.com. I think they're coming this weekend. I've got one. I get a great interview, a story with this YouTuber, the 8-bit guy, who's a guy my age who just was like, I'm going to build a computer like the one from when I was young. And he just made this computer that you can go buy right now that's like 8-bit and you can write, it rules. I've actually had it in the background a couple of episodes. And also I have an Apple Lisa episode of This Old Tech, which is maybe the coolest thing I've ever done at IGN as far as like video. It's like, it's awesome. It's almost like an essay. Anyway, one more thing I want to shout out. Everyone at PAX who came up to say hi to me. This was a record-breaking year. I lost count of how many people came up, and a lot of people were like, hey, this is just to like our show. They're like, NVC got me through the pandemic. Like, we love listening to you every week. This is such, you're such a good show. Like, I love the cast. So like, everybody was awesome. Every interaction I had at PAX was the best. Like, everyone there is so cool. I had one guy a little on the edge. It was a little combative coming at me, but I turned him around and he shook my hand. He shook my hand and he said, you have a strong handshake. And I was, that's because I'm jacked, bro. That's not actually what I said. Okay.
Did he come at you strong saying that Tears of the Kingdom is not the best game ever? Is that why you guys got off on the wrong foot?
Yes, that's exactly what he said. He's like, actually, I think that Mortal Kombat is the best game of all time. And I said, that's wrong. And then we did a whole Billy Madison thing. So it was...
I was at GDC and doesn't quite have the same atmosphere as PAX East, so I did not have the same experience, but I was hanging out with industry legend Kat Bailey waiting to get into a place for dinner, and somebody walked up to her with headphones on, stopped, lifted up the headphones and said, I'm listening to you right now.
That is crazy.
It was Axe of the Blood God. It was her podcast, but I've never seen that happen before.
I had that happen on one of the first dates with my now wife, and I made a joke to the guy where I was like, hey, thank you so much, dude. I'll send you $100 after this. Thank you. you made me look amazing.
Yeah, I've never been recognized with my wife, and I'm always hoping that'll happen. I'm like, oh no, guys, no, it's me. But then also be like, right, babe, you know what I mean? So eventually we'll get there someday. So one last thing I will talk about was that we did this amazing CDI Zelda panel. It was Jared Petty, some other people, Limited Run Gaming kind of put it on, and the kind of surprise of the whole thing was that the developer of Arzette, which is the spiritual successor to those games, except for it's actually really good, he found the person responsible for the original illustrations of all the backgrounds of those games. He's just this local guy. He also found the original voice actor for Link, who came on stage He's like just a sweet guy. He's like a teacher. He delivered the sure is boring around here line, and the place exploded, dude. It was unbelievable. It was a meme come to life. I am desperate for video of that. I know there's some out there, but it was unbelievable. Just this really humble, nice guy who just like accidentally found out, oh, I'm a meme forever now. So, all right, let's get right into the show. I've yammered enough. We are talking this week about a new recurring segment we're going to have on the show, the three must-play Nintendo Switch games. And eventually, we're going to put this into a face-off, which you might have seen on the site before, but basically, like, two games are randomly picked. You pick which one you want. You do that over and over and over again, and whichever one kind of gets the most votes, wins the most face-offs, rises to the top. And we're doing this by category, because it wouldn't be fair to, say, like, what are the three must-play Nintendo Switch games? That's going to... Maybe there's an indie in there for you, but we're doing it by category. And this week's category is the three must-play Nintendo Switch first-party games. And this one's kind of easy, actually. I don't know, for me. Or so I thought. But then I was like, man, I got to see exactly what is a Nintendo first-party game. And I looked up a list, and there's so many games that I actually was paralyzed.
Yeah, that's only three?
Yes, yeah, there's four games that Nintendo... published first party, and you have to pick three of them.
So Mario, Zelda.
Yeah, it's kind of like that. But I wanted to, Logan is off this week, but his picks real quick. Number one, Tears of the Kingdom. Number two, Super Smash Brothers Ultimate. Number three, Super Mario Odyssey. And the honorable mention is Splatoon 3. So those are Logan's. We're going to put them all into the like database that Logan runs, actually. So I'm just going to kick this back to him. And now I put it to the panel. Panel, Reb. Awesome shirt, by the way. It matches
your
lipstick.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah. I love my Super Ninfrendo shirt.
I signed someone's Super Ninfrendo shirt at PAX.
Aww.
What?
That's adorable.
Yep. So, Reb, what are your three must-play Nintendo Switch first-party games? And it's okay if we have repeats. That's fine.
I found this so difficult because I was trying to like balance what my personal must plays were with like what would I recommend to a friend.
It's what your person. It's go with
my
your
personal.
Heart.
Okay, your that heart. Does make it a little easier. So I think Animal Crossing New Horizons is like my first and like okay. like unshakable. Everyone needs to play this. It's so good.
It's a very good one.
Yeah, nothing is like that game. Oh my goodness.
Well, except for the other Animal Crossing.
it is the best. It is the best of them.
Yeah, it really is.
It is the best of them. Gosh, I have like 500 hours in that game.
Wow, that's a lot. That's
so many.
And she's still paying back Tom Nook.
I'm still nope. No, I'm not. I'm not. I'm debt free. I believe. I think I did. It's been a while. Yeah. I haven't thought about it. I think I had a really hard time deciding between Breath of the Wild and Tears of the Kingdom. I think like Tears of the Kingdom is an improvement on Breath of the Wild in basically every way, but Breath of the Wild was like groundbreaking in very specific ways, whereas Tears of the Kingdom was an evolution, not a revolution. So I had a really hard time. I ended up writing down Breath of the Wild, and now I say that and I'm like, oh, maybe it is Tears of the Kingdom. I think it's Breath of the Wild. I think I would pick Breath of the Wild. If you're going to play one, I don't want to put both on here. If you're going to play one, I think I'd do Breath of the Wild. And then my third is Luigi's Mansion 3, I think.
Okay.
Great game.
Oh, such a good game. It's so underrated. It's not underrated. It's under-talked about, I think.
I think that's a great way to put it, yeah. I think it's adequately rated, but I don't think it gets brought up in enough conversations other than the conversations about which Nintendo games we don't talk about enough.
Yeah, it's genuinely, I think, one of the best games on the system. Like, it's just start to finish, polished, beautiful, like, has exactly as much as it needs. Silly, fun for one person, fun for two people, really inventive little puzzles. A little bit on the easier side at times, but, you know, clever. I love the area design. I love all the little, like, humorous goofs in it. It's just really good. It's really fun to play. And then my honorable mention is actually Ring Fit Adventure.
Awesome one. Yes.
I don't think there's a single game in the world that is quite like Ring Fit Adventure. It is a very good RPG, and it is also a very good fitness game. I'm still playing it. I freaking love Ring Fit Adventure. God, the music. It gets me all fired up.
Oh yeah, that's a good list. That's a strong start. from Reb in the Mountain Stronghold, but I want to see
Reb in the Mountains.
The Mountain Stronghold.
She's got the suspenders, so it kind of fits.
Oh yeah.
Jada. I was trying to remember what your name was.
What my
week.
Name
Head
was.
Head Honcho so. Jada. What are your three absolutely must-play Nintendo Switch first-party games of the week?
So I went back and forth on this a lot. I initially was like, you know, I'm going to go with the big ones that everybody's going to talk about. Tears of the Kingdom, Super Mario Odyssey, and probably Smash. But, you know what? I after thinking about it and kind of, like, weighing through, like, which games I'm going to play the most long-term, I swapped it up. So my number one is Super Smash Ultimate. You guys know I like to fight.
Strong.
You know I'm competitive. Yes. I like to throw people off of ledges, spike them to their doom. That's Smash is
and
that.
And you play Smash Brothers.
And I play Smash Brothers, you know, on the weekends. But like, Smash is one of those things. It's such a cultural phenomenon when Smash is in the zeitgeist. It's all anybody thinks about. It's all anybody talks about. It's all everybody's asking is like, add this character. I want this character. I want this character. We want so many characters. It became such a big thing that we went from purely Nintendo characters to now we've got Sonic and Snake and Banjo-Kazooie. And it's got all these, it's just perfect culmination of all these different characters. And I don't know how they're going to top it in the next one or when we're going to get the next Smash. But I would be remiss to not put this at the top of the list for me personally.
Okay.
No, fair I think what you totally nailed it in that, like, this game is so much bigger than itself. It's the road to it. It is the conversation around it. It is the every single Nintendo Direct, every single event at all that Nintendo's involved in. When a Smash is actively in development or out and their new characters could be coming, turns into this entire crazed thing. Where every single person is just like Mallow from Super Mario RPG, you know, Goku. Like, it's just so much fun. And I think with this one, obviously, you know, there were some characters that I would still wish would show up. But like, this one feels pretty complete. It's okay. But like, whoever wins, you know, we get new characters in Smash, so it works out.
Exactly. Yeah.
I considered putting this on my list, and I think I had it like written down as a note, but I think Seth saying it was a personal list was sort of the thing that clinched it for me. But if I ever had to end up in a debate with any of you about this, which I guess I probably will at some point, I don't know how I would fight you on Smash, because I play it very casually. I play it when we have people over and it's like, oh, let's just boot up Smash Brothers and play for a little bit, like as a goofy sort of party game. But boy, was I so into the hype around what characters would get into it. And I played it a lot at launch, and it's just Smash Brothers, I think, maybe even more so than any Mario game, is like the quintessential Nintendo game, like above all else. I think the only thing that maybe comes close to it is Mario Kart, and even then I still think you would say it has to be Smash Brothers.
I agree.
I think that's fair. All right, Jada, what else you got for us?
Okay, my number two. I also went very back and forth on. But again, my competitive nature won me out. I'm going Splatoon 3. Splatoon is Nintendo's like newest franchise that has seen success, and it's just really that they've like really put time into. Like, yes, we're on the third iteration, but I mean, that's compared to like how many Marios are we on? 40? Like it's been a while. We've got so many Mario games, so many Zelda games. Splatoon is this new thing that is, I still consider a new franchise, a new IP to Nintendo, and it just is unlike anything else that Nintendo does. It gives you guns for the most part. Like, there's not many other games that where you get guns if it's not attached to like your arm when it comes to like Metroid for Samus or your ship for Star Fox, which has just been wildly unsuccessful as of late. And I'm really hoping they make a comeback in the next generation. But I love Splatoon. I love the camaraderie. I love how goofy it is, how expressive they allow you to be. The fact that they're constantly churning out maybe not new content, but community updates and stuff like that. Yeah. And having those different polls where everybody is picking a team and then fighting for that team. Whether you're, I think the most recent one I saw was like, are you a Friday, Saturday, or Sunday weekend person? It's been a minute since I've logged in, but like, it's just great. And we just got the side order, DLC a little bit ago, which is the roguelite mode. It's so good. It's great. Fantastic. I love it.
Who would say Friday, by the way? Like, I've got nothing left in the tank by 7 o'clock on Friday.
No. Like, exactly. But yeah, I love Splatoon. It's also one of the other ecosystems that Nintendo actually invests in for competitive. Like, it's this and Smash is where they're really dedicating their time and putting stuff into. Now, whether they do a great job of supporting those things externally from what they do... Well. Not really so much, not all, nine
that's
times
the
out
Nintendo
of 10.
Way.
It is the Nintendo way, and that's okay. They like, we all know Nintendo they like to control what they put out, and that's just their way of doing it. I love Splatoon.
I've said this before on the show, but what I love about this game, just aside from the fact that, like, yeah, when it first launched, it was very clearly and openly developed by like the younger generation of Nintendo developers, is that it's sort of antithetical to a lot of their previous core philosophies, which were collect stuff in games, tidy them up. Like when there was a messy character in Super Mario Sunshine, like you had to stop him from making a mess, right? Yep. When you open Animal Crossing, like people yell at you for having crap all over the town, or like your roaches show up in your house if you don't keep it clean. That happens in real life too. You should please take care of your stuff. But in this game, they're like, get out there and make a mess, throw paint everywhere, destroy everything, get messy, get gross, get weird. And I love that. It feels so different than like, if you go to like any, like if you ever go to Japan and you go to visit like a game studio or a Japanese office of any kind, like you expect to be like, oh, it's gonna be so cool. I'm going to see Nintendo. I'm going to Square Enix. I'm going to blah, 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 Namco. And you walk in there and it's just completely clean white walls. Very minimalist, very organized. Everything's very buttoned up. There's very little pieces of art on the walls, and they're all perfectly hung and framed. And then you play Splatoon and it's just like graffiti paint thrown everywhere. Yeah. It is just total chaos. It's got this like sort of like vintage St. Mark's New York City vibe to it that I adore. So yeah, right there with you. Love it.
Yeah.
I think most of Nintendo's like super popular franchises go back very, very far to the earliest days of Nintendo's consoles. And one of the very few exceptions is Splatoon. And I'm just so proud that proud's not the right word. I am continuously delighted and impressed by the fact that they were able to pull that out of their hats during the Wii U generation and say, no, we actually still can come up with really inventive and interesting things, and we're going to keep doing that. And then they came up with ARMS, which was fun, but did not take off in the same way. So I'm glad we at least have Splatoon.
It didn't have legs.
Didn't have legs. Shut up, Brian.
So good. All right. Jada, all right. Next
number
pick.
Number three. This one should come as no surprise to many on the cast. It's Pikmin 4.
Okay.
Pikmin
no
4.
Surprise.
A little surprised?
No, not at all.
I have not been shy about my love for Pikmin. I love those weird little dudes that I get to pull from the ground, from the earth, and throw to do my bidding. It makes me feel like a great evil mastermind. Maybe not always evil, but a mastermind nonetheless.
Sure. A head honcho, if you will.
A head honcho, exactly. I love Pikmin 4 so much. I don't think I would put like previous Pikmins, if we were making this list back in the Wii U or the Wii or GameCube era, I don't think I would put Pikmin at the top of my list back then. But Pikmin 4 did something so magical that really just brought the franchise back into kind of the mainstream minds of Nintendo fans, to where like people are like, what is Pikmin? And now now people are like, Pikmin 4 rocks. Should I go play the old ones? How do I go to play them? Which one should I play first? Like it's come back into resurgency, and I can't wait to see what happens with Pikmin 5. Because I loved everything they did with Pikmin 4. I hope they bring back the co-op features that they had in the previous ones, where you can play with other people instead of just against. But I love Pikmin 4.
Adored this game. I actually had so much fun talking about it with you last year when you were reviewing it. And I think you brought your Switch to a party that I was at, and we getting to see it early, I was just like geeking out. I I 100% of this game. It's also like, this game is amazing in that you'll play it for like 20 something hours and then be like, oh, okay, I guess I'm getting close to the end. And then it just opens up and there's a whole post game that's, you know, almost the same length and all these challenges to go back to. It's gorgeous. I really like, I was kind of bummed to see this not get the recognition it deserved on the year end list last year. Mm-hmm. Like this is, you know, I'll be honest. Like, I think this is a way better game than Mario Wonder. I think that one's not going to age as well. I think that people are going to go back to this one and figure out that maybe they slept on it and it's really, really special. It's really deep. But it's also something that you can play totally casually. It's just, it's incredible. I love this game so, so much.
I think Mario Wonder will have legs to where people will, it will look back at it and like want to go back and play it as like, because for, you know, the younger generation, you know, Brian, your kids' age group, they're going to be this, that's going to be their 2D Mario. That's going to be their Mario, Super Mario World. Their Mario 3. It's going to be that one. So I think it will do that. But I agree that I think that Pikmin will be kind of, it's going to be one of those ones like, what's this? Should I play this? I didn't play this back then. I don't think that, I think the majority of people who are older have already played Mario Wonder and that aren't probably going to go back to Mario Wonder. I think once they've played through it, they're done. But I think Pikmin 4 is one people will go back to.
It also, Pikmin 4 also has way better bosses than Mario Wonder. I'll say that.
That's true.
Yeah, yeah. It's true. 100%. But yeah, I love Pikmin, and so Pikmin 4 is my number three must play.
What's your runner up?
My runner up, because it couldn't be Nintendo without this guy being on there. Mario Odyssey. Odyssey. I love Super Mario Odyssey. I still have to go back and collect a bunch of moons. Like it's one of those ones where it's like I don't want to finish it all the way because I just always want to have a reason to go back and play more of it. But yeah, I love Super Mario Odyssey, and just the Cappy was such an ingenious addition. It brought back that Super Mario 64 mindset of speed running levels by doing all those crazy dive and throw Cappy, bounce on Cappy, throw Cappy again, bounce again, just climbing up things that most people wouldn't even think to do to get up there, but like it brings up that really cool hardcore Mario fantasy of being able to just like move Mario however you want him to move and go wherever you want, wherever you please.
Watching the B-roll, I'm getting fired up again.
This game is so
yeah,
good.
Like one of the most clever and creative video games ever made, hands down. Like just for sure. So, and like for as like a lifelong Mario fan, this was just a delight. I couldn't believe how many fun, crazy ideas they put into this game.
Yeah,
it's and so they worked. Jubilant.
Like, and the music. The music. Oh
my God.
The music. I love the music.
Yeah. All right. Brian, let's hit us with your picks, please.
Okay. So a couple of them got said already. Obviously,
no, that's okay.
No, it's all right. I got backups. Obviously, Tears of the Kingdom. I'm not going to start there. I think that's one of the best Nintendo games ever made. I think it has the best ending of anything they've ever made. Playing that game straight through with my kid. One of my top three video game memories ever. But nice. I'm going to go with a different Zelda game because I'm on this show and I have to plug it. The Legend of Zelda Link's Awakening.
Yeah!
That is the whole... I didn't say that one because I knew Brian was going to put that on his list because me and him that game so much.
I'll get
I'm
it
so
out of the way.
I'm so glad you love it because people were really hard on the remake and I thought the remake was phenomenal.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, same. I mean, like, I'll get the technical issues out of the way. Some Switch games have been plagued with them. This game gets a little choppy in the overworld sometimes, right? Like, the frame rate is not totally up to snuff. I personally didn't care because this was a dream come true for me. This was my favorite Zelda game of all time. Getting this gorgeous new coat of paint in this like really beautiful sort of half claymation, half stop motion toyetic look that was just stunning. They added a whole bunch of cool quality of life stuff. So you didn't have to keep going into the menu to switch out things. You could map a bunch of different items to different buttons and stuff like that. It was just really, really beautiful and really well done. Just a great excuse to revisit a game like this. This game is very near and dear to me because the original was a game I played on the Game Boy. And I remember just like being curled over my Game Boy as a kid and just playing this game obsessively and just having my mind blown that a game of that caliber and that size could exist on a handheld. And then getting this again on the Nintendo Switch, where you could play it as a handheld, you could also play it as a console game, was just wonderful. I helped work on the guide for this game with Casey DeFreitas, who did an amazing job with the guide. I believe she wrote the entire guide in first person. So it's, which is like just very, very clever.
Best.
Yeah. And yeah, there was like a, you know, not a ton of extra content and stuff like that, but some nice Easter eggs, some nice extra things to find and go look for. And so I loved it. I just absolute delight playing this game. I'm so happy they made it. I really, really hope they take this engine and for Switch 2, they remake the Oracle games the same art style. Awesome. Cause like those are awesome. They just put those games on Nintendo Switch Online on the Game Boy thing. And I started playing them again. They're really, really great. I think that like they could also benefit from the same sort of like, you know, HD remake approach here where you can map buttons and all that. But yeah, I mean, this game is so weird. It started as a remake of Link to the Past in the Game Boy. And then the Nintendo developers decided, hey, let's go strange with it. Let's throw a bunch of like Twin Peaks and weird, bizarre dream sequence stuff and 2D platforming, like just, you know, with Mario enemies. There's, you know, there's
Kirby's in this game.
Kirby's in this game, but he's evil. I mean, Chain Chomp. Like, so yeah, shout out to Link's Awakening. It also, yeah, it had this kind of not, you know, not super deep, but had like a very kind of fun Zelda Maker light, right, that was in there where you could go see the weird guy that lives in the graveyard and build your own Zelda levels and share them. So, yes, shout out to Link's Awakening. Not the best Zelda game on Switch, but, you know, just a wonderful delight that this even got made. And, you know, personally, fantastic. Made me so happy. The fact that that got remade and Resident Evil 4 got remade, all I need is a Bloodborne remake and my three favorite games of all time will be there. So whatever, you know, whatever gods have decided those first two, get to Bloodborne. Next up, we said Pikmin 3. I'm going to go in a slightly different direction because that was on my list, but Metroid Dread.
Had that one. That was what I was on the fence with Dread. So, I'm so with you. I want to hear it.
Dread is a very special game to me as well because as hardcore old school Nintendo fans know, or longtime Nintendo fans know, Metroid Dread was a rumored game for a really long time. Mm-hmm. And rumored like before they were like, you know, before... Rumored like what when video game magazines were rumors, right? Yeah. Like before it was like you know,
the Quarter Man.
Yeah, exactly. Like before there were big like leaker YouTube accounts and Twitter guys that were just like, you know, that's watching all this stuff. There's like a whole leaking community now, right? This is a game that was rumored to be in development and then rumored to be canceled. And we all got the, you know, 3DS Metroid remake, which was a it was pretty good, right? It was a remake of arguably one of the weaker, but still incredibly ambitious Metroid games, which is the one they made for Game Boy. And they did a pretty good job with it. And then the same team came back a couple years later and made Metroid Dread, which added this like weird sort of survival horror element. We're getting stalked by these killer robots. It's snappy and lightning fast. It's the, you know, to wait years and years and years for the Metroid Prime 4 logo to turn into an actual video game has been heartbreaking, but to have this hold us over in the meantime is fantastic. If you slept on this game or like you only played it for a few hours, I urge you to go back and give it a shot. It's one of those games that like, I think it starts a little slow, but it genuinely gets better and better and better as it goes along. So yeah, shout out to Metroid Dread. 100%. Up there with like some of the best modern Metroidvania games, which is really cool to see. Let's see, last but not least, this was really tough for me. Let's do it. Super Mario RPG.
Okay.
Okay, so everyone's mad. Okay, good.
No, not mad.
I think that's a
I'm curious.
It's lovely. It's an absolutely lovely game. I would love to hear your reasoning.
Uh-oh, Reb's mad specifically. Reb's ready to fight.
If you're not watching, Reb just threw her headphones down and walked away.
I just picked up Big Mary Ape and smashed its fluffiness. Go ahead, Brian. I
can't
this.
Speak on behalf of Reb, but for the rest of us that that really love the feeling of joy.
Oh,
wow. All right. I don't I don't know what to say to that.
I'm kidding. So no, I know. I understand. I have two remakes on my list and a sequel to a remake. So you know,
rules here, man.
Showing my age, if my head isn't. But this was like, you know, they didn't, just like Link's Awakening, they didn't need to reinvent the wheel here. But they did take a classic game that was effectively landlocked to the, you know, the SNES and the SNES Mini.
Yep.
And I think it might have been on the Wii.
It's on the Wii Shop channel.
Wii Virtual channel. A virtual console. But wasn't on the 3DS, wasn't on the Wii U, isn't on Switch in its original form. They did such a beautiful job with this game. They took a classic, weird, bizarre pairing of Square Enix and Nintendo during the golden ages of top-down 2D RPGs before those two got divorced and split off and the PlayStation was invented. And they took this...
Final Fantasy had two Christmases. So.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, goes good. They took this old, weird, charming, strange, funny game that's not the deepest RPG, but it's like one of the most definitive and one of the first action RPGs ever in terms of like the combat was dynamic. You could interact with things on the fly with the right timing and do some really, really cool stuff. This is not a long game. This is not a deep game, but it's the kind of game you can plow through in a weekend, maybe a little longer if you want to go back and 100% it. But it's full of really, really charming, really cool secrets, really great characters and stories, really goofy bits. It was one of the first games that really allowed Princess Peach to be like a really cool character on her own. It brought in characters that we still haven't heard the end of, like Gino, you know, which I think a lot of us revisited this game this year and we're like, Gino has like four lines in this game. Why did you want him in Smash? Like Mallow's the dude. Like Mallow should be in Smash.
Justice for Mallow.
Yeah, it also let you play as Bowser and team up against a new villain, and like that was kind of mind-blowing at the time. And so yeah, like I know that the Switch is defined by these big, you know, AAA feeling games like, you know, Super Mario Odyssey and Tears of the Kingdom, and I adore those games, but I really, really like how they sort of padded the in-between months of those big games with smaller titles like this that I think really show sort of the breadth of the Nintendo Switch's library. And so I'm really happy I got to play this game. I'm really happy they remade it. You get to beat up a horrible wedding cake in it. Great.
One thing I will say about this one, when it comes to like the battle system, I love how it evolved throughout time, because yes, you're still doing not quick time, but like those action, like timed presses.
Yeah.
Like it changes as you go through and get different weapons because there's different animations and such. Yeah. And that's something you usually don't get in these types of games, where like your timing is always the same. It may be different for like specific special moves and stuff, but this one changes like your basic attack animation if you have the hammer equipped with Mario or if you just are punching people in the face, like I like to do in games. It's a very different animation and timing and such, and so I really like that. I don't know. I don't know if I'd put this one on my top three, Brian, but I definitely do have a very soft spot in my heart for Super Mario RPG.
It's a beautiful, lovely game.
Reb
and wonderful.
Hi.
Reb is silent.
What's your beef?
I don't have beef with it. I think it's very sweet. I think everything you said about Super Mario RPG is true. It is seminal. It's very, very lovely. I just bounced off of it twice now, I guess. I tried to play the original, like, several, I think it was, I can't remember exactly. I think I was playing it on like
if you bounce off of it repeatedly, it makes a noise over and over and over. You get a combo out of it.
No, I think it was it might have been on the virtual console or something on the Wii U, and I played the original and I tried it. I didn't get very far, and I was just like, it's fine. I think the time of it has passed. I have played so many like wonderful, deeper, more intricate RPGs since. Like clearly this was a big deal in its day, but. You know, I think I've moved past it, and that's okay. And so I let it go. And then they remade it, and I thought, oh, well, maybe this is it. Maybe playing the remake will work for me. And I did get quite a bit farther in the remake. You know, I recruited Gino, I recruited Bowser. You know, I got a bigger group together, and I saw a little more of the game. But I bounced off of it again, and I think I think I wouldn't consider, I wouldn't put it in my three like must plays on the Nintendo Switch, just because I would consider this a must play on a much older console back in the day. Okay. I think the remake is just not, I'm glad it has one. I'm glad that we have better availability of games like this. But yeah, it didn't dazzle me in the way that I think it dazzled a lot of people. And I wish it had. I really do. Because I love RPGs and I love the spirit of this. I love so many of the games that came out later in this tradition. Like everybody talks about the Paper Mario series, and I'm real jazzed about everything they're doing with that, especially Thousand Year Door coming up.
Same,
but
yeah.
I am a big lover and vocal proponent of the Mario and Luigi series, and I feel like those games very much carried on the tradition of what I played out of Super Mario RPG, and I freaking love that this exists. But yeah, no, it didn't land for me the same way it landed for others. Fine.
My stance on the Mario, I guess the Mario and Luigi series is the same way I feel about like the Mario versus Donkey Kong series, where Donkey Kong 94 is fantastic, perfect game, and that everything after that is kind of like not as great. And so really? To me, the Mario and Luigi games are not as good as Super Mario RPG, and I've been chasing that high ever since, and I've never... Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
Speaking of old Game Boy games that need a remake, Donkey Kong 94.
I really disagree with that. I think that they evolved all of that considerably. I think the writing just continued... I think Super Mario RPG set a very high baseline, and I think by and large through games like Dream Team and Paper Jam and all those other ones, I think the writing continued to get better. I think the combat continued to get more interesting. I think the music continued to improve. I think they continued to do more interesting and weird things. I do agree with some of Logan's complaints that they started relying a little bit too much on Toads and Toad variants, but that's a relatively minor complaint. I love all the games in that tradition, and actually I'm a big fan of the more recent Paper Mario games, which are kind of away from RPGs, but
that's where the timeline kind of splits for me, because I do love a lot of the like kind of classic, and the best Paper Mario RPG games I think are up there with Super Mario RPG and some of the best. I think that like my beef is sort of with the Mario Luigi games, which head in a direction which I've never really been truly in love with, but we got some really really good Paper Mario games, and they're remaking probably the best one for Switch very soon. So yeah, I'm into it.
All right.
Yeah.
Brian, what is your honorable mention?
This is tough. So nothing.
But it can be anything, because it's an honorable mention. It doesn't go on any lists.
Okay. I will say. I don't have to say. Can I say Tears of the Kingdom then?
You can say Tears of the Kingdom.
Okay. Have we talked about that game before?
We haven't yet. But
we've never spoken about Tears of the Kingdom.
Did I hijack this show for 4.5 months last year and talk about
this
game?
In case people at home, it's actually The Legend of Zelda: Tears of the Kingdom. It is a continuation of that series.
Okay, so I'm gonna piggyback on something Reb said earlier about and I'm not targeting you, Reb. You know I love you. I think that you make a really good point about Breath of the Wild having more impact and being more revolutionary, and then Tears of the Kingdom being sort of a little bit more additive to that. But I think that like the more I think about it, Tears of the Kingdom, and I believe like we even talked about this a little on NVC last year, like Tears of the Kingdom makes Breath of the Wild hard for me to play in some ways. Like I think that like there's a lot there, and it's hard for me to remove the initial impact of what that game had on me, which was, you know, no pun intended, legendary. Like I remember like almost tearing up seeing that first trailer for Breath of the Wild, and like seeing the grass move and stuff like that.
Oh my God.
Like
remember, we didn't think it was real.
Yeah, it wasn't for a really long time. That's why. It took a very long time for that game to come out. And covering it was awesome. Playing it was awesome.
Oh my God.
But the creativity that Tears of the Kingdom brought to the table in terms of building and sort of structurally, and the expanse of that world, and going above and below, the way it played with those tiers, like literally, and the depths, exploring that, like the weapon variety, the creativity in terms of like making things in that game. I've always been like a very sort of tactile, like I love to cook, I love to create stuff. I went to art school. Like the idea of like having this infinite sort of sandbox full of toys and creativity was ingenious hilarious to me. And also, like, that you would invariably make a bunch of very wonky, dumb stuff that doesn't work good. You know, man. Like, for
so
all the
many bad things.
Yeah. Like, you would open Twitter and you'd be like, some guy made a Metal Gear. And then you'd open the game and you'd be like, my sword float good. You know, like... So, like, I really love that. I thought the temples this time around were like a much, much bigger improvement.
Yeah.
Still not where they need to be, but like very, very clever, very creative. By the end of the game, like, you know, having 9 idiots following you around who, like, you would hit the A button wrong and they'd blow wind everywhere. Like, that got a bit much. Oh my God. That he could not wait to do that. But the end of that game, which, you know, it's been a year, I still won't spoil, is just magical. Like, I straight up cried. I had tears of the kingdom on my face. Oh, man. And
beautiful.
I've never been one to shy away from it. I did not care for Breath of the Wild. And so, like, you know, I've said this multiple times. I think it is a fantastically designed game. It is very revolutionary for the space and gaming as a whole. It just didn't connect for me for what I wanted out of a Zelda experience.
Fine, fair enough.
And if you want to hear my take on that, there's like 12 other episodes where I've said this kind of spiel, but Tears of the Kingdom.
Jada, I file you next to the people who are always like, I hate Resident Evil 4 because it turned my favorite survival horror franchise into like an action horror franchise. And
it's just time crisis now, basically. Yeah.
That's how I felt about Resident Evil 5, honestly. And so, like, I respect that opinion. There are games that hit a franchise that split the sort of timeline forever. And Breath of the Wild, I believe, did that. I think that, like, the genie's out of the bottle with that, and I don't know if they'll ever be able to truly put it back. So I respect that, even though if I totally disagree with it.
Well, and it's totally fine, and I'm happy with people disagreeing with me on it. I'm glad, and I'm so happy so many people discovered their love for Zelda. It is still my favorite Nintendo franchise, despite not being on my top three today. The Switch Zeldas just haven't been there for me, minus Link's Awakening, but I left that off because I knew Brian would have me covered there. But Tears of the Kingdom is one of the ones where, like, I actually started to feel the magic again for the first time with Zelda on the Switch. And, like, I love everything they did it. I loved how the community was just everywhere with this game for months on end. And there were so many little things hidden that, like, it was like, did you find this? No. Did you find this? No. Like, okay, I'm going to go look for that tonight now. It was like swapping homework, you know, swapping notes from class.
Yeah, it's like back in the old days.
Yeah.
Oh, you go to be like, hey, do you know if you push this button here, this will hole will appear? You're like, what?
It was like Reb, you were talking about Animal Crossing, right? Like during the pandemic, like I actually, like, you know, your phone does this dumb thing where that shows you haunted photos from several years ago and either puts you in a good mood or a bad mood. And mine the other day showed me a picture of me and Max Scoville dressed like we dress in real life, standing next to each other in Animal Crossing because it was like start of the pandemic and we couldn't do that. And then opening up your Twitter and just seeing like all the stories spilling out from that. Nintendo recaptured that with Tears of the Kingdom, like that sort of cultural moment of, you know, we are all like, oh, I didn't know you could do that. Watching people do things, it was just like I've never really experienced anything like that before with a Zelda game, where seeing the creativity and you know, ignorance in a lot of ways too, just like silly things breaking. It was so much fun.
So I love that, and it's still, I think it takes the cake for the best Master Sword sequence of any Zelda game as well.
Yeah. Oh my God!
You know, like why we did a whole episode on, you know, wear your best clothes when you're going to grab the Master Sword, because you want that cutscene to look fantastic.
Oh my God.
Don't wear a stupid Moblin hat unless that's your favorite thing. I support Tears of the Kingdom. But
good.
I wanted to
come have a better frame rate than Link's Awakening. I'll never understand that.
I want to sneak in really quick because I feel like I misunderstood this segment and I had to go first, and I just listed my games and gave absolutely no... These two gave like these beautiful arguments for their stuff, and I'm not going to hijack the podcast, but...
Hijack away.
Please love... We're doing a face-off. Vote for Animal Crossing. It was freaking great. Also, I think I like Ring Fit Adventure more than Luigi's Mansion 3. Okay, thank you.
Oh, okay.
Reb, my last name starts with an A, so the amount of times I had to go first in class was every time.
Damn.
And the amount of times I had the book read, ready for the presentation was zero times. So
I did read the book. I just like listed my games, and then you gave these very deeply compelling arguments for these games. Everyone was like, "Oh, Reb doesn't know anything about these games she loves."
Oh, you being too hard on yourself. Reb,
no, that
I'm
wasn't
sorry.
The takeaway. You're one of the most researched and you know ingenious people I've ever met in my entire life.
Yeah.
If I ever have a question about Animal Crossing, you're the person I go to.
Yeah.
Anyway,
and
those games are
you're
great.
A bit of a tastemaker. Your opinions hold an enormous amount of weight. People absolutely love it when you recommend games, when you've been talking about an indie game you've been playing, which we're going to get to in a minute.
Hell yeah.
First, I'm going to go through my list.
Yes, please.
Obviously, what more do I need to say than Tears of the Kingdom, the literal greatest game of all time,
so
created by human hands on the face of the earth in history, the absolute best representation of what a video game is and should be. Now, you know what? Screw it. I'm going to beat it this weekend. I'm going to do it.
What?
I'm going to finish that game.
What bombshell? Are you really going to do it? Can we hold you to that?
I'm going to do it. I can finish it. I'm at the point where I could just go and finish it.
Do you know the ending? Like, are you aware?
No, I don't know the ending at all. So I'm pretty stoked.
I can't wait to talk to you about this next week.
Yeah. So like literally... I'm realizing
spoiler
like, well, I could just I could just go and do all the other side stuff, like, but I could also just beat the game. I could have it both ways.
When we were doing the NVC, like, what was it called? Talk of the Kingdom.
Talk of the Kingdom.
We delayed the final episode of that show for like literal weeks because we kept checking in with ourselves and with the audience. And we were like, can we do the ending spoiler cast yet? And they're like, no. We don't want to finish that game yet. And we were like, we don't either. So I don't blame you. But please finish that game. Please.
No, I'm going to. Good. The reason, like I've said it before, I just didn't want it to end. I was enjoying it, like just being in that world so much. More than maybe any other game. No, not more than maybe. More than any other game that I've ever experienced in my life. I enjoyed being in that world to a level I did not know could be possible. So that's obviously my number one pick. My number two pick, also kind of vanilla, Mario Odyssey. Absolutely just lovely game. The Donk City segment is still, like, I think maybe the single greatest, most joyful moment in any video game in history.
It's really good.
It was such a surprise that I've never smiled so hard for so long at a video game. My third pick, which I'm really surprised no one has said yet, Metroid Prime Remastered, which was a little bit of a surprise drop. But that is the best, absolute best way to play one of the absolute best games of all time. And I think it's only like $39.99. So if you haven't gotten it yet, what is your damn problem? It's like one of the best games ever made. Holds up amazingly well. The new coat of paint just looks wonderful. It still feels atmospheric and spooky and wonderful. And I love it. It's got new effects. And that one rules as well.
Also,
my runner.
I want to say real quick, I'm so happy this game exists. It's out. And we don't have to have rumors about it anymore. It's real.
Yeah.
You can play it. It's there.
No,
it's,
but
don't worry. The rumors have moved on. Now we're doing Metroid Prime 2 and 3. I don't know.
Yeah. Everyone's like, oh, the next one they're just going to release they're going to release them both at the same time.
Oh,
because
my God.
Nobody truly believes that. My honorable mention is probably the weirdest and least successful game of all Nintendo first party games for the Nintendo Switch. And I bet that the sales numbers are lower than but I absolutely think everyone should check out Game Builder Garage, because it literally teaches you how to program games. And I don't mean it's teaching you like how to write C++, but it is teaching you the sort of the logic that
the
you
fundamentals
need, and the fun, like the things that you don't learn from just learning the language, the things, the logic and the way that you have to approach problems in order to make a game work. And it's cute and it's fun. It's actually kind of hard. I reviewed this game and I had a little bit of trouble with like getting my head to wrap around some of the lessons, but it's a wonderful, and I'm a little disappointed there's not a community that kind of propped up around this, because I think this is a great way for kids especially to learn game programming. Now, there's like MIT has a language called Scratch, which both my kids did, and it's sort of the same way. It kind of visualizes the way that these logic trees have to play out. But this is just—it's got that Nintendo edge.
I completely forgot this game existed.
I did too.
I bought this one for my niece because she's very much at that age where she's like figuring out what she wants to do, and she loves video games. And I was like, here, try this, play this a bit. She's built some levels, some pretty cool stuff.
Yeah.
And so like, I'm very excited to, like, I haven't checked in with her in a little while because it's cities away, and haven't had time to visit with all the craziness, but like super excited to see what she's got cooked up next time I visit. Like, yeah, this is fantastic. I'm so glad you recommended this, Seth, because I honestly forgot this game existed. Don't and I everybody. Bought this game.
they should have called it like Mario's Game Garage or something, and they would have quadrupled sales. Mario's Game Shed.
But check it out. I'm begging of you. It's wonderful. So that is an awesome list. We'll put these together. They're all going to be listed or put together in like a playlist, and then there'll be a face off at the end when we have like all the segments. But for now, I want to talk about why most of us were gone last week. And it's because we were at GDC and PAX East. So I want to take maybe like 10 or 15 minutes to talk about some of the games that we saw there, because like, first of all, PAX East is almost all indie developers and every one of them rules. And I'm going to say this one right now, because I don't want to run out of time. There was a dude whose name was Colin. He came up to me 3 times. Can I show you my game? He wasn't up, didn't have a booth. He was just there. And finally I had time, cause I was like between shots. I was like, yeah, let's do this. Pulls out a Steam Deck. He has this game called Royalty Free For All, which is a Smash Brothers type game using characters that are in the public domain.
Oh my God. So, I love it.
Funny.
Concept alone, I'm like, I'm sold. And then, but like artistically, the style of it has this great cartoon style and it's fun to play. And the dude was just a total sweetheart, absolutely passionate. So Colin, what up? Royalty Free For All. It's like, it's so early that you like, I mean, he's demoing it to people on his personal.
That's so cool.
Deck, but that's it. But all right, now I got that out of the way. Reb, you and I talked about this game really excitedly.
Oh, yeah.
That is a little game called Animal Well, which and I both played separately on both opposite sides. I see Brian, but
are they
it's
okay?
Kind of famous. I would say my biggest
they're in the well
thing about the animals that are in the well. It's kind of the opposite of Lassie. Like Timmy is actually outside, the animal is in the well.
Okay.
This game,
yeah, legit.
The main character is not an animal. It's like a blob.
No, it's like a little.
Kind.
Is it a well?
But there's bunnies in the well. But
not. You're like a little blob guy. Oh my God.
Yeah, this looks awesome.
Oh, it's have you not seen good, this, Brian?
No, like, no. Dude, this looks gorgeous. This is.
Oh my God. So this is the kind of claim to fame is that, you know, Video Game Donkey has a publishing company now, and this is the first game that he's publishing. So when I say to people, oh, I played Animal World, they're like, oh, Donkey's game. I'm like,
No,
publishing it, which is great because it does give the attention to the creator, Billy, whose last name I'm completely forgetting right
now.
Blasco, thank you. Who I got to talk to for like way longer than our segment required.
He's lovely.
Like we were just chatting about like, CRTs and PVMs and chiptunes and just like life in general. He's just an awesome dude. Played this game, beautiful. It was my game of PAX and the game that I'm most looking forward to. It's coming out May 9th. This game, like, dude, Brian, like,
I love it.
This game is completely your jam. The sound effects, the music, it's amazing. But Reb, what did you think of this game?
Yeah, I've played Animal Well at several different conferences now over the last several years. I played it before it was cool. I played it before Donkey picked it up. I just want to say that.
Nice.
But yeah, it's really fantastic. You play as this little blob, and it's kind of like this puzzle platformer game. The blob by itself is... The blob is terrible. It doesn't jump very high. It doesn't move very fast. It doesn't have any attacking abilities. It's just kind of this blob that's very weak and vulnerable. This whole game reminds me of Rain World a little bit in that regard, because you play as the slug cat who can't do anything in Rain World. You move around this environment, and it is, if you're like a secret finder or someone who likes to just experiment and sort of figure out how the world works, this is a great game for that, because it tells you nothing. You're in this sort of like dark cavern exploring, and you're not really given any guidance or direction. You just kind of go and see what you can figure out. And there's all these there's strange animals in the well. There's all these like beautiful rooms. It's this pixel art, but it's like very highly detailed, and the animations are absolutely gorgeous. And as you go along, you know, there's many things that can kill you. The one we're looking at in the trailer right now is this weird like ghost cat kind of thing
that
will just sort of come out of nowhere at you. There's a bunch of other things that can murder you, and you know, I haven't played far enough to actually figure out what your goal is, so I can't tell you what it is, but you're trying to survive and make progress and figure out what's going on. And there's different items that you can acquire as you explore these areas. And the one that I always remember from early on is you can find like these little plants that basically operate like flares, and the game doesn't tell you what to do with them. You just kind of pick them up. And if you show up in the room with the cat and you blow them up in there, it distracts the cat and gets the cat away from you so you can proceed through the room. I think that's right. It's been a bit since I played that room, but yeah,
I did not get that far. So
yeah, but that's like one of the things you can do. And there's a bunch of little items like that. Like I've seen in trailers, there's a frisbee you can get that you can throw for a dog to get the dog off your back. And there's a yo-yo and a bubble wand that you can use to sort of platform your way up things. And there's all these like different bits you can find. And it's a game that very much leans into the energy of ARGs, where you're sort of trying to piece together what's going on, what all these clues are leading to, what's really happening. And it's just, it's definitely beautiful, and it's weird, and it's interesting, and it's fun. Yeah. And I'm so excited this is finally coming out.
Like Billy's just been developing this on his own for the last 7 years. And so this is like the culmination of like his sort of like, I guess, well, work of the last 7 years, obviously. But he was telling me like there's three layers of secrets. There's the secrets you find when you're playing through the first time. Then there's a whole nother level of secrets that you find on your second playthrough. And then there's like, well, like you were saying, Reb, like ARG, like secrets that kind of, he didn't get into those very much, but there's a deeper layer of secrets to uncover. And I'm like so stoked for this game. It doesn't look, other than it being pixel art, like Fez, one of my favorite games of all time. I kind of get that feeling from when I played this game. I cannot wait. This is maybe my most anticipated game coming out anytime soon. So
it's one of those games that makes me go, what's its deal? What is it doing? I need to know. Yeah. Tell me what the deal is. But I don't want it to tell me. I want to figure it out. Oh,
yeah.
I'm so excited for this.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
So this is coming to Switch, PS5, and Steam. Did I see that correctly?
Yeah.
Yes, oh my God. Indeed.
Yeah. I'm all over this.
Yeah, I will play this on Switch, like 1,000%.
Oh my God, for 100%.
Great looking
Switch. He's telling me, like, some point people are like, oh, you should put in a thing where you can turn the CRT effect off. And he's like, why?
Why?
It doesn't make any sense. I'm like, oh man. And then we dabbed up, and because we're bros now for life. Not really true, so. Reb, what other games did you see at GDC that you would love to talk about?
A really quick one I want to shout out that will not take me long at all is actually one that I haven't played yet and couldn't tell you much about, but I went to the IGF Awards, the Independent Game Festival, and I love going to the IGF Awards every year. If you're one of those people who constantly complains that certain award shows are not nearly award showy enough, check out the IGFs and then the GDC Awards that follow. But the IGFs are really great for discovering games that you might never have heard of before that are superb, like that are winning awards from their peers before they're even out yet, because they are just that excellent. And there were two games, there were actually a lot of games in there that stuck out to me, but there were two specifically either out on or coming to Switch that really blew me away. One of them is called Once Upon a Jester. It looks very much like visually it kind of reminds me of Night in the Woods. I don't know a whole lot about it just yet. I haven't gotten the chance to purchase it, but I'm going to. But it seems to involve like this troupe of performers.
Oh, this is a Reb ass looking
who are
game,
trying
yeah.
to do a little theft. And my partner actually went to a panel that these developers put on, and they were talking about like doing comedy and making this game funny. And they were talking about how they deliberately left incorrect voice acting takes in the game as sort of a joke and like a meta commentary on what they were doing. So I'm really curious to check out Once Upon a Jester and see what that is all about. Cause again, I don't really know, but it won, I believe it won like the Seamus McNulty grand prize for like the best game on the IGF. So I really want to see what this is all about. And then the other one that I really, oh, go ahead.
I was going to say, that's how they recorded a lot of voices for the recent Ninja Turtles movie, Mutant Mayhem, by just like letting the kind of cast like riff with each other and they kept those takes in. And I don't know. I love that idea coming to games. A lot of game VO feels like, you know, extremely deliberate. And so getting a little looser and crazier with a game that looks like this is delightful. That sounds so fun.
I mean, it just reflects real life. Mm-hmm. Like, not all conversations, you don't have a script for every conversation. And sometimes
you didn't get this week's script.
Sorry, guys.
You're doing great.
Oh man, I'm. I took an improv class or two.
Well,
can I do that again? You didn't get this week's script.
Yeah.
Well, you're doing great.
The other game that came out of those awards that I really wanted to talk about, but again, have not gotten the chance to play yet. I did just download it though, so I'm gonna play that soon. Is called Mediterranean Inferno. It is a visual novel that is about these three childhood friends, these three young men who kind of go on a summer retreat to a place in Italy to sort of recover from their experiences going through the COVID-19 pandemic. And they apparently sort of combat inner demons and you know, deal with the things that are deep in their hearts and learn something about themselves in the process. I'm hoping Red can grab some footage and put it up here really quick, because this won a bunch of awards, which really intrigued me. And the premise is kind of, you know, vaguely interesting when I explain it. But when you see visually what this game looks like, it's like, oh, that's why she's into it. It just has a really, really incredible visual style. It looks like it has a really cool setting. It looks like it maybe goes places. Maybe there's demons involved. I can't really tell. But I see
demons.
It seems super duper cool. It was a finalist for the Seamus McNulty Grand Prize. It was a finalist for the Nuovo Award. It was a finalist for Excellence in Narrative. I think it won one of those, and I don't remember which one it won. I didn't pull the list up before the show, but
nice.
Yeah, absolutely. It looks really phenomenal. I love the visual style of it, and it looks like it's just full of personality and
that one's called
maybe some grief. Mediterranean Inferno.
Nice. I don't trust the IGFs at all, actually, because you can't spell Igferent without IGF. That's such a stupid joke. That's not true. I think that IGFs are good.
No, they're really good.
This is before we move on, because we have an awesome conversation and we're kind of running short on time. This is maybe the most Brian Altano-ass game that I've ever seen.
Mm-hmm.
It's called Questmaster, and it is literally Zelda Maker.
Oh my God.
Because
yes.
It started out as like a fan project. I talked to the developer. It started out as a fan project where it was Zelda Maker, and then he just adapted it and made this. It looks like Link to the Past, but you can make your own dungeons.
Oh,
yeah.
It's got co-op play. There's a demo on Steam right now. You can check it out. But I met the dude. He's this German guy whose name escapes me. It was not that much of a German name, but it was a German name nonetheless. But yeah, absolutely check this out. Download the demo on Steam right now. I don't know when it's coming out. But like, I love this. And in fact,
oh my gosh,
when they sent like the email, because when you get a media batch to PAX, you get thousands of emails. And we got this one from Apogee, who's publishing this. And I saw that. And I was like, okay, 100% have to check that one out. And it ruled. The guy was awesome. The game was like super fun and it's beautiful. And so Questmaster, go check that one out. All right. Since we are short on time, I'm going to do a truncated MiiVerse and just throw it to longtime friend of the show, but sadly never on enough, Brian Altano, because you had a wonderful experience playing Princess Peach, and I would love to hear about it.
Yeah, so you guys talked about this game a bunch on the show recently, right? But I wanted to come in from a slightly different perspective as a father of a five-year-old girl who has literally spent, 6 weeks now crossing off the days on the calendar until this game came out.
No way, that's so cute.
Yeah. I did the preview event for this game with Nintendo in New York City a couple months ago, came back, wrote my script, uploaded the video, and that video has become one of my kids' like favorite videos to watch.
Aww, that's so
and it's God. It's I'm getting closer and closer to sort of explaining to her what I do for a living, and I still don't truly understand it myself, so I you know,
none of us
I understand
do,
she doesn't.
So that's cool.
So yeah, we it came out on Friday, and such a weird coincidence, she woke up with a stomach ache that day and couldn't go to school.
Crazy.
I know.
Crazy.
It's so weird that happened that day.
I hope she feels better. Wow.
Yeah, I hope she feels better. So I figured, you know, the best thing that we can do for your stomach ache is to stay home all day and play Princess Peach Showtime. I hope that's okay. So I called the school and I was like, hey, she's not feeling great. And I turned to her and I was like, I know you're feeling great. Let's go play this video game.
Yeah, school sucks.
Yeah, parents in the chat, sign off and let me know.
We all know.
You know what? Shame me for the counting that we missed in kindergarten that day.
His daughter's principal is a longtime fan. It's gonna like mark this on right. record.
She missed show and tell. That was 80% of her final grade.
She's not getting in any colleges now. Yeah, she didn't. Yeah, she didn't do show and tell. They didn't count jelly beans that afternoon. We know enough about this game. I finished it last night without spoiling it or anything. What a brilliant game this is in terms of getting just a ton of mileage out of a really specific theme, which is giving Princess Peach her own game. Which obviously they've done before, but doing it in like a really smart way this time, where instead of giving her just like power-ups, you go into different theaters, you get different costumes. Those costumes get a lot of play. And what I, pun intended, I guess. I'm sorry. Amazing. And what I love about it is that
are a dad.
Yeah, I know. It just seeps in. I thought that you would, play each level with one of these costumes and move on. But what happens is like you'll play a second level with them. And when you do that, you get this kind of glowing thing on Peach's chest, which tells you to go down to the basement and unlock a door, which you unlock the last one. And by beating that, you free this thing called a Sparkla. And collecting all of them triggers the end game sequence where you fight the main boss. You get a really cool costume. And it's just like that, there's some really clever post-game stuff. And, to sort of add on to my bad parenting, last night I sat down to play this game with my kid around 7 o'clock. I usually put her to bed around 7:30 or 8. Then suddenly it was 8:30. Can we play one more level? One more level, Dad, please, 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 please.
Oh my God.
We got to the end and I was like, she was like, we can't just go to sleep without beating the main boss. And I was
she had a point.
You're right.
She's right.
I know. She's right. And she's my kid for sure. So we stayed up late. We beat the game. I had like tears in my eyes because she was jumping for joy.
Oh my God.
This is a game for younger audiences, but it scales well in the classic Nintendo way. There's a lot of stuff to go back and find to 100% all the levels. Takes a little bit of work. So yeah, if you have a kid or you're looking for just like a really charming, really well done Nintendo first party game to play right now in the quiet months before the bigger stuff starts coming out, please just give this game a shot. I really, really love it. I hope they make sequels. I think they will. And I'm just really glad it exists. So yeah, shout out to Princess Peach Showtime.
I love that she brought up that argument. If we can't leave the last boss,
I know.
Like we can't. Yeah. Like right. That argument would not have worked with our parents growing up. Like it's just like no, turn it off, go to bed.
Yeah, I got to use it in reverse at 7 o'clock this morning when I got her ready for school. I was like, I know you're tired. Get downstairs. You had to fight the main boss, didn't you?
Wait. So this is a game that's obviously very clearly primarily aimed at children, kids, but you still had fun with it.
I did. Yeah.
The thing is that everyone, when we talk about the Mario movie, says, well, it doesn't matter if it was bad because it was for kids. Are you telling me that something that is for kids can also be enjoyable to adults? Because I don't think that's, I'm just riling up the comments.
No, sure. I get you on that. And like, I think that like, honestly, there's a lot of really bad games that are just for kids, but yes. I think that like Nintendo does a magical job in the same way you can point at Disneyland, right? And be like, that place is just for kids. But like when you go there as a grown up,
you see my wife and sister-in-law like
and like you spend 3 days there, and by the third day you're like, I think I could rock a Donald Duck shirt, stuff that you would never say in real life. It works, right? Like I think that like there's a lot of really bad stuff for kids, but like something like Bluey is like a great show for kids that also adults are laughing with. I think Princess Peach Showtime does the same thing, right? So and that's a really hard needle to thread, and they did a really great job.
That's exciting. I don't really have any reason to play it other than the fact that I host a Nintendo podcast. Mm-hmm. So I think I'll check it out. My kids aren't really into Princess Peach.
Baby girl stuff.
Helldivers 2. So
yeah. just call it bonding time with your kids and just make them play it.
Princess Peach is for all genders and all ages.
I agree.
Absolutely. And then when my 20-year-old comes home from working the shift at Walmart today, I'll be like, hey, let's play Princess Peach. And I know the answer will be, leave me alone. I'm going to go compose some music in my room. So, all right. It's question block time. We have a couple questions this week. Carl DeNovio asks, which video game alternate universe would you like to get a peek at? And for some examples, he says, Nintendo PlayStation, Sega doesn't torpedo their own hardware business, Virtual Boy is a massive success, the 1980s video game never collapsed, never happened, something else. So I'm curious, what alternate video game universe would you like to peek at? And I will point out that actually years and years ago, over 10 years ago now, when 1UP was still a thing, there was a theme week, What If? And I wrote an article for them that you can't even find anymore. The kind of conceit was, we write these stories about things from this kind of alternate universe. And mine was that the ET game was good and it was a massive success and that it like reinvigorated the video game industry. So I love this sort of mental exercise. So I'm curious to hear what some of your takes are. What alternate universe would you like to just pull the curtain back and see how it turned out?
I would be super curious to see what the video game world looks like if Nintendo, instead of going this hybrid console route where we have a Switch that can be docked or can be a handheld, sort of flipped the script and went full handheld. Like after the Wii U was not a success. They ditched the home console business entirely, but they go all in on sort of what they were doing with the 3DS and start just like really, really going hard on handhelds. I'm curious like how that looks, especially with the mobile market being what it is, but then with Nintendo specifically making first party games that are dedicated handhelds. Cause like I've long held the belief that a lot of game franchises that were previously very much at home on Nintendo's handheld consoles have tried to make the leap to Switch and have struggled. I think Pokemon is a wonderful example
that's
of
fair.
That.
I
think many of the farming sims struggle with that. Rune Factory, there are many examples. And
ironically,
so,
not Farming Simulator, though.
Ironically, not. But yeah, I'm curious, you know, what does it look like? What does it look like if the Pikmin of this generation had to be handheld? If instead of Breath of the Wild and Tears of the Kingdom, we got more handheld Zeldas? I don't necessarily think that the world is better off for them having done that. But I'm just curious, like, what creative direction would they have taken?
That's really fascinating to me, because could you argue that we would still get Breath of the Wilds and Tears of the Kingdom? You would just you'd be forced to play them on a small screen, or
I think we would just keep getting
handheld?
I think we might get them, but I think they would be multi cartridges.
I don't.
So it'd be like you have to pop in a password when you move to the next cartridge.
No, I don't. Think
every time you went to the depths, you'd be like, "Oh, I gotta go to the depths again." This game.
I don't think they would have done that at all. I think they would have instead of evolving the 3D open world exploration side of that franchise, I think they instead would have taken a huge leap in how they do top-down 2D puzzlers. I don't know what that leap would have looked like. I'm not a genius like they are over there, but I think we would have seen a similar like expansion of what a Zelda can be, but in the top-down 2D realm. And I'm curious what that would have looked like.
It blows my mind that we really haven't gotten the follow-up to Link Between Worlds. Right?
That's
adored that game. It's stuck on 3DS. I would love to see. I don't know if I would love to see that at the expense of the Zeldas we have now, but it's a shame that we don't have that. Right? Like I do want them to be kind of juggling both of those things.
Yeah, I agree.
It's another great irony that the Zelda game where you turn 2D for half the time is stuck on the 3DS.
Right?
Jada, what do you think? Where are you at?
I really love the Sega doesn't torpedo their own hardware business, because there's a big Sega follower back in the day. But Reb inspired me, so I'm going off script. Sorry, Brian.
Again.
I know you spent all week writing the script for me, but I'm throwing it out. It's gone.
Diva actors out here. It's impossible.
No, hey. It's just what I do. I want to see an alternate universe where instead of Nintendo innovating for different control schemes, when we went to the Wii, the generation of the Wii, where they instead chased the dragon and went for high definition graphics, so where it was on par with the PS3 and 360, and what Nintendo's landscape would look like if they went and they was like, we don't care about, you know, like creating these like, we're still going to have these really creative things, but we're going to focus on graphics now. It's going to be very high definition content. And I know that's like it's interesting for me to think about, because there's so many people that put off playing Nintendo games because the graphics aren't good. It's not 1080p. It's not in 4K.
Those people are joyless.
And it's so it would be interesting just to see how their games would have evolved. You know, what Super Mario Odyssey and Breath of the Wild and Tears of the Kingdom would have looked like on a PS4, PS5 level graphics engine. Like, what that would have looked like. And, like, for me, I honestly, I don't know if it would have looked much better, like, just thinking about it, because, like, Odyssey and Breath of the Wild, like, Odyssey specifically, and even Luigi's Mansion 3 look fantastic. They're like their art style and just how crisp everything looks fantastic. And I don't even know if I would want that to be in a higher definition, because I think a lot of their charm is in that art style that is granted by going at that lower definition.
Yep.
Now, I'm not saying I don't want them to ever move into where everything is 1080p and higher stuff. Obviously, we always want, you know, things to move forward, but I don't think Nintendo like needs that.
No,
as much as the other consoles do.
No, they've proven time and time again that they don't need that.
But I thought it'd be interesting to see if we didn't get those, like, if we didn't get a Wii and a Wii U. Like,
oh my God, we got the Wii Box 360 or the Xbox Wii 360. Anyway, Brian, what alternate universe are you curious to see inside of?
Well, I'll say real quick, one that I don't want is the Wii U is a hit. Because I think we wouldn't have gotten the Switch had that been a tremendously successful system on its own. I think the only reason we got the Switch when we did was because the Wii U didn't really pan out for them.
You Wii U haters. I love my Wii U.
We love the Wii U!
I spent years on this show defending that system during the dark ages when there was literally nothing to talk about except for like the Rosalina amiibo. It was tough.
Best amiibo.
We made a meal of it. Like, we really did. The Nintendo PlayStation thing is fascinating to me, but
yes.
The other what if is there was a demo for a Zelda game that they did once that was like,
oh yeah.
Not necessarily. Yes. Yeah. And this I'm torn on because my timeline might be wrong here.
It was
here,
the game that turned out not to be Wind Waker, right?
It turned out not to be Wind Waker, correct.
And everybody was mad as hell.
And so, and I adore Wind Waker. And so I don't want this timeline to accidentally remove that game from my memory because Toon Link is part of the pantheon of Nintendo characters.
You're just taking a peek. You're not committed to this universe existing. Yeah. You're just looking to see what happens.
I would have loved to see what the sort of like, you know, HD or whatever HD was back then.
480p.
The 480p follow-up to Ocarina of Time would have been like, right?
Yeah.
Not necessarily, because I don't necessarily feel like the Zelda franchise needs to go into like a gritty, mature direction. But getting a glimpse of that, I think they did a really interesting job in that demo of like playing with shadows and dark and light.
Yeah.
And I think just tonally the way that was kind of shot and put together was really fascinating to me.
Yeah.
It sort of captured the original feeling of like creeping around a old like dungeon in the original Zelda game where things felt dark and creepy. So I would have loved to see what that game looked like completed.
Yeah.
And exist in that world where that exists, and also Wind Waker still comes out.
Yeah. Have them both. Yeah, I think that's a great answer. I'm just gonna real quick say like Nintendo PlayStation. I would love to see where that, because we wouldn't like think about the ramifications in the industry. We wouldn't have a PlayStation. We wouldn't have a podcast beyond. Would Greg Miller just be a guy? Just a guy? Would Brian and Jada just like only know each other from being on this show? The mind reels at the infinite possibilities of what that could have meant. But unfortunately, that's all the time we have left for this week's Nintendo Voice Chat. Before we go, as always, I have a few favors to ask of you, the best audience in the world, and I ain't even lying. If you're watching us on YouTube, leave us a like and a nice comment. If you're listening to us on a podcast app, leave us a review. Help spread the good NVC word. We will be forever in your debt. Thanks again to everyone who came up to me at PAX to say hi. And remember, NVC is the only damn place where you can
get the
thing.
Get thing.
Get the thing.
Dang it.
Get the thing.
The script.
Get
thing.
Get the thing. Get the thing.